Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, the book today is a brilliant book. It combines humanity, evil, and present day. The book is called The Lotus and the Storm. It's written by my guest, Lan Cao, and it's published by Viking. Welcome, Lan.
Thank you so much, Connie.
And what a book, and I am sure much of this is based on your own experience.
Yes, the majority of it is, although not everything is. And however, everything that happens in the book actually is the truth in somebody's life. So everything in the book happened.
Then let's begin with the family in Cholon, which is outside of Saigon. And the father is an officer in the DM Army. The grandfather had been kidnapped. I mean, that part, you know, you read that in the beginning and it goes, it could have happened yesterday. The grandfather had been kidnapped. He was a wealthy officer and the army had kidnapped him, the Viet Cong. And they sent back, in essence, his head. They had decapitated this man. And yet the family went on. The family that was his daughter, Ki, and the two girls, Mai and Khan. Young girls, one is, what, 9 at the time, the other is 6. So that it's the early part of their lives and that period of 67, 68 in Vietnam.
So that part actually, The main character, Minh, being an airborne brigade commander, that was modeled after my dad because he was, in fact, a commander of an airborne brigade. And my mother's father, my mother came from a land-owning family in the Mekong Delta. So at this point in time, historically, the Viet Congs were trying to terrorize the villagers in the rural areas of Vietnam. And one way they did that was to try to implement some of the land confiscation methods that they had done in the north in 1954. So they captured my grandfather, in fact, and there was word of where he was being hidden. So my father, being an airborne brigade commander, tried to pinpoint the location and jump in to save him, because there were a lot of peasants who supported the landlords as well. And the peasants had given word as to where my grandfather was being hidden. But by the time my dad got there, he had already been decapitated.
I mean, we've been seeing it on TV lately because of ISIS. Oh. And I have to say, there is nothing more prehistoric almost as this type of cruelty of man to man. There's a wonderful Chinese sort of nanny for the girls, and she really supports them because the mother, Ki, unlike what one expects in an Oriental household, she's a businesswoman.
Well, actually, you know, in Vietnam, Vietnam is very different from other countries in Asia. So it is very common for Vietnamese women to be businesswomen. So for example, some of the things that you have heard about that happened to women or that reveal their lower status in Asian society is not the case with Vietnamese women. It's very common for Vietnamese women to be completely in charge financially of the household. For example, you hear that Chinese women had foot binding. That was never the case with Vietnamese women. And we have a lot of Vietnamese women who were warriors, who led armies of male subordinates when Vietnam fought against the Chinese. So the mother in the book, in fact, was a businesswoman and took care of the family finances. And there was a Chinese nanny who took care of the two girls. And at the beginning, there's some rumblings about what would happen to the Chinese when the communist brother of the mother came to visit.
And his brother number 2?
Number 5.
Number 5. Yeah. And there's brother number 2, and then there's a man named Fong, who is from sort of like early training period in the Air Force with the father, Mr. Ming, who plays a strong role. He almost is like a Iago.
Exactly. He is just like an Iago. And in fact, unfortunately, in the South Vietnamese government and the South Vietnamese army, there were many Iagos who were double agents for the Viet Cong. So for example, I based the character Phong on many people that we have now discovered to have been Viet Congs all along, who were in fact pretty high-ranking officers in the South Vietnamese army. There's a famous South Vietnamese reporter who worked for AP and Reuters, who was giving information to the American press, including Morley Safer, and Morley Safer wrote about this in his book when he returned to Vietnam, who was a Viet Cong all along. So Pham, in that sense, had a hidden life, and that hidden life was very much designed to infiltrate South Vietnamese society and then destroy it from within.
There are scenes after, I guess before even, Mai and her father escape. The sister, Khan, has been killed in one of those terrible accidents of a bomb being thrown, and she is cut with the glass and she dies. This has an effect on the younger sister that she becomes not tongue-tied, she becomes speech-tied. And discuss that a little bit, how it happened.
Well, in the book, the two sisters were, even though they were not twin, they were metaphorically twinned. And the younger, the main character, Mai, basically adored her sister.
And
when the sister died,
yeah, she becomes silent. It's almost as if she has taken inside of herself her sister's personality, her body, her everything, so that the father ends up feeling he's talking to the both of them.
Right. So the kid who remained had a hard time.
Yeah.
Dealing with it, and I guess suffered from various traumas.
And it happens, too, that the mother at that point, the father and the mother have never come back to the same sort of adoring relationship. Not unusual, by the way, for families that have lost a child.
What I wanted to do in the book was to structure this mourning from loss on two different levels, right? So the first level is the child, one of the adored child, being dead and the shattered the family, and the parents, who had a very loving marriage, never recovered. The other level was the fact that the country itself never recovered after the assassination of President Diem. So South Vietnam, without doubt, never ever had a truly stable government after the assassination of Diem. So for a period of several years after, there were successions of coups and counter coups.
You begin the book, though, with Mr. Ming and Mai. Now they are living in Virginia, where there is evidently, like here in California, a little Vietnam.
Right.
And everybody, they live in sort of the same compound building, and they depend upon each other. One of the people, women, is Mrs. An, who takes care of Mr. Ming because A, he's older, B, he's not in good health. Mai, by this point, has gone to high school and gone to law school and is there taking care of her father. She is a silent person, though. She doesn't want to be in the court. She is in the law library.
Right. So I think it's a lot of people, such as myself, found a lot of comfort and solace in books. So if you are an outsider, I think you feel completely immersed in the world of books, and you feel suddenly that there is a place that you belong. So the fact that she chose to be a law librarian shows that she has a fragmented life, and her way of coping with it is to enter a world where all things are possible and where you can be any character you want. So that's the world of books. And then with Mrs. Anne, she's a boat person in the novel who escaped Vietnam after 78 as part of the boat people exodus. So she stayed and she works in a nursing home, but she lives in the same apartment building as the father. So she's sort of the repository of his stories as well, along with Mai, and she took care of him. So a lot of the father's stories are told to her, Mrs. Anne, and she's part of this small Vietnamese community. It's smaller in Virginia than in Orange County, to be sure, but it's still a pretty close-knit community.
How did you get out of Vietnam the way Mai did?
I got out of Vietnam in a few months before 75, so right before the final exodus. My father was in the army, so he knew that probably, I mean, this is in retrospect. I imagine he knew the end was coming, so he gave me up. My parents drew up formal adoption papers to allow me to be adopted by an American soldier who at the time we met him was a colonel in the U.S. Army. And so we met him in 68, and he finished his Vietnam tour. He returned to the U.S., but we remained extremely good friends with him. So in 75, he flew back into Vietnam to take me out. So my parents weren't sure whether or not they could leave, so they had all the papers ready, and I would be adopted if they were not able to leave. So I moved with his family and lived in Connecticut for about 6 months. And then when my parents came, I moved back with them.
And I would, not having known that, but now hearing it, I would say that the character of Cliff is pretty much based on him.
Yes, in fact, he's such an important person in my life that the character Cliff was based after him. And also with my prior book, Monkey Bridge, Uncle Michael was also based on him.
Uh-huh. Is he still alive?
He died in 2001.
Oh, yeah. Because anybody, the way he's portrayed, I hope his family enjoyed reading it. James Baker is interesting because he was a non-commissioned officer, and he was in the Army, but he falls in love with the girls. It is, and it's not on a bad side, it's just he loves the children. And he is heartbroken when Khan is killed. And he runs through the book even to the end. And in a way, it was a way for Mai, at her age and his age, to recreate a time that would never come again.
The character James, you know, I knew many, many American soldiers when I was growing up. In fact, most of my friends were people like James, who had a base very near my house on the same street that my house was where I grew up on. And in many ways, you know, there are so many American soldiers who served in Vietnam and did so with a lot of love and with a lot of courage. So I wanted to tell that story because a lot of times when you read books about the Vietnam War and the vet, there's a lot of attention paid to the horrible things that happened during the war, but not about the very special bonds that were in fact forged between individual American soldiers and the South Vietnamese population.
You have captured in the book the horrors of what happened to men in prison. How? Did you have no people this happened to? Fong, who goes in and has not a wooden leg, but a metal leg. The cruelty is unbelievable of what goes on in those Viet Cong jails. I'm going to ask you if you would just read a little bit from your book. Let them hear your wonderful writing, but also the facts.
they had confronted him in the most mundane of ways: a knock on the door, questions from the police, an exchange of lowered voices. Two minutes later, he was taken away. 2 days later, there was another knock. My wife and Kui were there when it happened. "He is an invalid," they said frantically. "Only one leg. Look." Two rolled up the bottom of my pants to reveal the fleshly incompleteness, obscured by the ordinariness of my trousers. I held myself steady even as they fumbled to pull at my pants. Kui took a fork and clanged it against my leg. The metallic sound was but an inconsequential abstraction to the cadres, who merely shrugged. It was this very sound, the tinkle of metal, that I heard over and over in my cell in the coming years. I answered their questions with alacrity. Tu and Kui did their best to intervene.
And Fong, it turns out, the one I refer to as Yago, is also, has been secretly a Viet Cong.
Yes, so again, his story is a very much of a tragic story, but also quite commonplace. As I said, there were many Viet Congs who infiltrated the South and who pretended to be South Vietnamese officers and South Vietnamese reporters.
But he never thought that he would be arrested. And I mean, that's the part that is so mesmerizing about how could they arrest someone who'd been working for them?
Because, you see, it's very common. The North, you may know the war was fought from the northern side, both the North and the Viet Congs, but there are two separate groups. The North were Northern Vietnamese Army soldiers, and the Viet Congs were Southern guerrillas. So during the war, there was a pretense that the war was mostly fought by the Viet Cong. That way, the North would be able to characterize the war as an internal Southern insurgency, when in fact, these Viet Congs were simply sort of used by the North Vietnamese Army, which then, in turn, was supported by the Soviet Union and the Chinese. So all of that connection was designed to be hidden so that all we hear about is, you know, mostly the Viet Cong. But, you know, if you look at the Ho Chi Minh Trail, North Vietnamese soldiers regularly infiltrated South Vietnam through the Ho Chi Minh Trail with ammunition as well as regular cadres. And they stayed behind a mask with the Viet Cong Southerners being the face. When the war was over, the mask was removed so that the Southern insurgents would be immediately removed from power, and there was an actual northern conquest of the South. So all decision-making rested in the North, and the Southern insurgents were never trusted, and most were then sent back to re-education camps. My uncle was a Southerner who was, in fact, a Viet Cong, and was never trusted and imprisoned after the war.
He was like Brother Five.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And as you read about what they went through in prison, the starvation, the filth, the subjugation, the embarrassment, it's really a litany of horrors.
It is a litany of horrors, and one of the things I really wanted, my most heartfelt objective in writing the book, is to let the readers, in this case, because it's written in English, the American readers and international readers, know what happened to Vietnam after 75. Because just because the U.S. pulled out in 73 through the Paris Peace Accord and was able to, quote, declare peace with honor, you know, does not mean that the place that you leave behind no longer exists on the earth. So there are a lot of terrible things that happen, one of which is, for the first time in Vietnamese history, an exodus of millions of people left the country, which nobody had ever left, even during the height of the war. So they obviously left because of the human rights violations that existed after the war in 75. And the re-education camps, you know, euphemistically called re-education camps, but were actually concentration camps. And if you interview people who were there, they will tell you that it's very sophisticated, because when international visitors came to look at the camps and to interview the prisoners, there would be nobody really following them. They seemingly had free rein, but in effect, the the prison system made it very clear that they knew all of the family members of the prisoners, so that if the prisoners dare said anything to the international monitors about how they were mistreated, their family members still in the outside world would suffer. So there are a lot of things that happen after the U.S. pulled out of Vietnam that really I want to bring to make a story out of it.
As well as Ki, the mother, stays behind. She evidently, she and Cliff have had an affair. She is pregnant. She does give birth. And when Mai comes back to visit the homeland and to bring her father's ashes back, she can't find where the child was adopted or where she went.
Right. So the relationship that forms a triangle among Cliff and the father and Cliff and the mother, and then the father and the mother both, of course, on one level are deeply intimate and personal stories, but they also, in my mind when I wrote the story, also wanted that to symbolize the relationship between the U.S. and Vietnam. So you see Cliff being a very good friend of the father, but in the end, betraying the father. He saved the father's life when they were in the Cambodian operation, during the Tet Offensive, I guess. And then in the end, there's treachery because he had an affair with the mother. He also left the mother, even though they had a very deep affair. And then the relationship between the father and the mother also represent North and South, because in the end, both of them were separated. Mm-hmm. One stayed behind, one went to the U.S. Yeah. So it's very similar to the divisions within Vietnamese society that's caused by war and post-war politics.
And the child would not be really accepted in Vietnam because of having mixed blood, mixed looks.
That's right. So all the Amerasians were referred to as half-breeds, not in Vietnamese, South Vietnamese society so much as more half-breeds when the communists came. It's interesting because when the French pulled out of Vietnam in 1954, my understanding was that they took all of the Eurasian kids with them. That didn't happen with the Amerasians, so there were a lot of Amerasians left behind. And they were badly mistreated, along with South Vietnamese army soldiers. And over time, the U.S. government then allowed, I think, a special program for them, for the Amerasians, if they could prove that they had American fathers, then they would be allowed to leave.
Lan, couple of questions about the writing. How long did it take you to write the book?
Well, it took me so much longer than it took me to write Monkey Bridge. It took me 10 years to write this book. 5 years to write and about 5 years to revise.
Yeah. Currently, you are professor of English at Chapman University?
Of law.
Of law.
Yeah, I'm a law professor.
Uh-huh. And what about not within the English department?
No, I don't have an English degree, or I've never taken a writing course. Really, so I wouldn't be qualified to teach in the English department.
Because recently I did a show with Richard Bausch, who's written a marvelous book, and he's in the English department. I was thinking, Chapman really is getting some very good, brilliant writers there.
Thank you.
Was there much of a transition for you from Virginia, little Viet Cong, to the California coast?
Well, the Vietnamese community here is much, much bigger, hundreds and hundreds of thousands. And I don't think that was the case in Little Saigon in Northern Virginia. But I grew up in Northern Virginia. I went to high school there. So, you know, I still miss that area quite a lot. The difference is the weather. I love the weather here.
But coming here, have you seen people you knew in Vietnam?
Yes. In fact, I did a couple of readings. I did a reading at Page's bookstore in Manhattan Beach, and lo and behold, four people I hadn't seen in a very long time, who was actually officers who worked with my dad, showed up at that reading, and they lived in California, so they went to the reading. And then I had a very wonderful reading at Barnes & Noble, which was sort of my book launch, and we had about 250 people from the Vietnamese community who came.
And it has to have been an interesting thing, feeling for you coming across them. And I'm going to ask you to autograph my book and tell you again how brilliant I think the book is. Meanwhile, if you would like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com or go to YouTube, Connie Martinson's channel. You'll be able to see this show again in about, a week or so. Meanwhile, support your local library. Go in, take out a book. That's how they get funding, with how much traffic goes through a library, as well as you got books you've read. Nobody really, they're taking up room on a shelf. Donate them. Every library can use extra books. And besides which, you never know who's going to be there reading. So support the library, and we'll see you next time. Thank you so very much, Lan.
Thank you.